jnana timarandasya jnanana sadakya shakshuranmilitam yena tasmai shri gurave namaha shri chaitanya mano bistam stapitam yena bhutale svayam rupa kadamayam rati svaparantikam jaya se krishna se
Yeah.
Yeah. Nitai Gaur Premanane Ananta Koti Vaisnava Vrindaki Jai. Hare Krishna. And in this one has to somehow. Oh, that's okay. Hare Krishna. Welcome once again. Om Gyan Timanandasya Gyanandana Salakya Shakshura Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha. So today, on this disappearance day of... Is it true? Disappearance?
Yeah.
Appearance, yeah, I was thinking, because it's 31st of December, 1st January. So on the appearance day of Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur and the disappearance day of Srila Gaura Kishore Das, of Srila Gaura Govinda Swami. Yeah. Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur is one of the principal acharyas for the modern age. After Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, the Srila Rupa and Sanatan Goswamis and the other members of the six Goswamis and their associates like Lokanath Goswami, Bukharba Goswami, they all took that Babaji Vesh, right? They all took this Sanatan Goswami. It is said he begged an old dhoti from his brother-in-law and subsequently he tied it, he tore it in four pieces, and then one piece he was wearing like a little lungi, another like a chadar, and like that he had two sets, and that was it. So it was very basic, you know, very basic. That chakta tunam ase samandali pati srinim sada tuchavat. They lived a very renounced life, although they had previously been very opulent, you know, lived in royal palaces and in Ramakeli. I mean, the amount of wealth that they had accrued there was enormous. But they were very careful. Very careful not to get entangled in the material energy. We see that Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu himself also displayed a very rigid level of renunciation. Like Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu would sleep on the floor. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu would not accept any comfort at all. So they set a very high standard of renunciation. But that was not the main thing. The main thing was that the six Goswamis were on a mission. Nana Shastra Vichara Naikanipano Saddharma Samstapako. They were on the mission to establish the true religious principles, which were lost at the time. And so many bogus ideas were floating around, and everybody and his auntie and everybody and his uncle and all the babas had something to say, some idea, but it wasn't based on scripture or an authorized interpretation thereof. So the six Goswamis, they very expertly established proper Siddhanta. And subsequently, in the generations following the six Goswamis, that Babaji Vesh, that particular style, that became the model. So everyone was living like a Baba, everyone was living in, to some extent, renounced, right? Some obviously more than others, but the point was they all imitated Rupa and Sanatana. Then we see that Srila Bhaktisiddhanta, he comes, right? And he does revolutionary things. First of all, he gets into the printing press, the Brihat Mridanga. Not just the Mridanga, but the Brihat Mridanga. It is Srila Bhaktisiddhanta that made that point, and that is the foundation of book distribution. Right? It's Srila Bhaktisiddhanta's order to Srila Prabhupada. If you ever have money, print books. And so these days, Srila Bhaktisiddhanta would probably be a BBT man, would be someone like involved, you know, with books and publishing and printing and together with Bhaktivinoda Thakur. And these publications, they were very engaged. They were not just propaganda, but they would engage with the local intellectuals. Like there was one man who criticized Bhaktivinoda Thakur and Srila Bhaktisiddhanta, and basically criticized Vaishnavas. Then they established, on the basis of scripture, that there are indeed so many sahajas who are not following any spiritual standards and so on, but they also established that there are bona fide Vaishnavas and so on. So in this way, Srila Bhaktisiddhanta, Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur established the, first of all, the tradition. They established the tradition. They established, there was a debate with Brahmins, because here these Vaishnavas were giving initiations, even to Brahmins, even to those born in Brahmin caste. Now, I'm telling you, I mean, that's a serious deviation. And, the Brahminical class must be honored. So Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur was supposed to go for a debate, but Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur was not well with arthritis and he couldn't get off the bed. So he sent Srila Bhaktisiddhanta. And Srila Bhaktisiddhanta, he began quoting from the Manu Samhita. And he began to quote various verses glorifying the Brahmanas. Right? So the Brahmanas were very happy. Right? So many verses they didn't even know. You know? They never heard before. And just go like, this is far out, you know. I mean, he's on our side. Right? And then after doing that, then he took it a step further. And yasya laksanam proktam pumsam vinabhijanjakam yad anyadrapi drishyeta tattanaiva vinyati said. And he established that one is a Brahmin not just by birth, but by qualification, by laksan, by qualification, by qualities. And in this way, suddenly everything changed. And suddenly, and he quoted so much evidence that that there was nothing anybody could say after that. And the crowd just went wild. And the debate was taking place in a hall. And the crowd, they wanted the water from the feet of Srila Bhaktisiddhanta, who said, oh, no. You know, no, not my feet, no. And then the people, they were getting serious. They wanted it. They wanted it, and they're ready to take it by force, and they're ready to break the building. So the owner of the hall, he took action to save his hall. And with his men, they grabbed young Srila Bhaktisiddhanta, put his feet in a bucket of water, and then distributed that to the crowd. And then the crowd became very peaceful and very happy. So in this way, we are appreciating that Srila Bhaktisiddhanta established himself like a very, very great scholar. So part one is where he is establishing the tradition of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and confronts smarter Brahmanism, which is basically claiming Brahminical status by birth. Okay. He does have one. Jeho. Vanamali. So, Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur became such an authority that no one could challenge him. And then, after having thoroughly established the essential points of the tradition, one of the other missions was to establish the birthplace of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, since he was a district magistrate and he had access to a lot of archives and so on, so he had dug up so many government documents showing the history of maps and this and that, descriptions of where the Ganga had been. And it was really clear that that portion in Navadvip, which was now claimed to be the birth site of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, was not at all Navadvip 500 years ago. The Ganga had moved considerably, and now Navadvip is on Godrumadvip, right? It said, like the actual Navadvip, there was a crossing just near Suvarna Bihar. There was a crossing where one could cross the Ganga and go to Navadvip. Yeah, so Navadvip is extending much closer. And the birth site of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was identified by Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur as Mayapur, and confirmed by Srila Jagannath Das Babaji Maharaj, who at age 125 was carried in a basket and jumped out of the basket, like everybody knows. And still, it's impressive. So that was a clear evidence. I mean, at 125, to jump out of a basket, there's got to be something like transcendental ecstasy. You can't, ordinary people can't do that. That's for sure. They might jump, and that might be the end of them. Anyway, so we're seeing establishing Bhaktivinoda Thakur and Jagannath Das Babaji, who was the most important authority at the time, established Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's birthplace. Gauravi Bhava Bhumistram Near Desa Satjana Priya Vaishnav Sarva Bhoma Sri Jagannathaya Te Namaha. So Bhaktivinoda gave the credit to Jagannath Das Babaji because he was very famous and no one would argue with him. Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, he constructed a temple there on Yoga Pit. And but it was Srila Bhaktisiddhanta who gradually began to establish the Dhamma on the ground. Srila Bhaktivinoda wrote the Navadvipa Dham Mahatmya, where he laid out the entire Dham surrounding Mayapur. And then Srila Bhaktisiddhanta started the Parikrama. And that wasn't just parikrama. That was establishing the topography of the Navadvipa Mahatmya as the holy dharma to the world. So that was not appreciated by those who claimed that Navadvipa was the place because, you know, there was good money coming in. So it was a monetary matter. Therefore, they were not afraid to spend some money to get some gundas and this and that. But anyway, Srila Bhakti Siddhanta, his disciple, dressed up in sannyas dress and ran. And there's a crowd, an angry crowd running after him. His disciple was young, so he was a fast runner, especially with a crowd behind him. So he did well. And Srila Bhakti Siddhanta escaped in white cloths. Anyway, but they established, so he established gradually this Navadvipa Mandal Parikram, which is still going on. And of course, ISKCON has now also started Navadvipa Mandal Parikram. And now, you know, anybody who claims that Navadvipa is the birthplace, you go like, yeah. I mean, look, you know. Just get on, that's where you get the boat, you know. That's where you get the boat to Mayapur, you know. If there's any doubt, right, and the big temple and this and that. It's like, now it's done, you know. The world can understand, right. Only sour grapes can now argue. Nobody really. So they did that, right. And Srila Bhakti Siddhanta worked very hard to establish the holy dham properly, and to properly understand where all the various places were. So that's an very important contribution, obviously. I mean, you know, now we fully depend on Sridhar Mayapur, and Sridhar Mayapur has become for us like a shelter, and it's the shelter of the whole world, right? And as Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur writes in his Praman Kanda of the Navadvipa Dham Mahatmya, in Kali Yuga, all dhams will become less and less manifest, and Mayapur will become more and more manifest. So that mission was the mission of these acharyas. Then Srila Bhakti Siddhanta, he was also establishing that that the Gaudiya Sampradaya was the Metta Sampradaya, the Sampradaya that could absorb all the others, because no other Sampradaya is complete. If you look at the Sri Sampradaya, then you see, for example, you see Andal, who is one of the Alwars. So first there were the Alwars who appeared before Ramanujacharya, and Andal was a great devotee of Krishna. And then there is Vedanta Desika, who is also a devotee of Krishna. But we see that they are taking Krishna as the eighth incarnation of Vishnu. So ultimately, you see Vishnu is the origin. But the thing is, they're totally into Krishna because there's more taste. So they spend all their time with Krishna, even if they have that little misunderstanding, it's the eighth incarnation of Lord Vishnu. Still, they spend all their time with Krishna because all the taste is there. So Srila Bhaktisiddhanta in Mayapur made a Chaitanya Math, and in the Chaitanya Math he established deities. This was his headquarters. He established deities of Gandharvika Giridhari. And there's a temple, there's a dome, a sikar, like Madan Mohan type of dome. And then with the acharyas with sitting around that little dome of the acharyas of the four Vaishnava Sampradayas. And whatever is offered to the deity is then offered to the Vaishnava acharyas. And the idea is that that temple is there to show that all Vaishnava Sampradayas will be united at the feet of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, because only here do we find complete ras, you see. We do not find in any of the other sampradayas. We find some ras, but incomplete, always mixed with awe and reverence. But here, which diminishes the intimacy with the Lord. But here we find the full loving exchange. Srila Bhakti Siddhanta started to reach out to the British, right? And for that he was ready to make some adjustments. He was even he was receiving important VIPs, a governor, and so on, in Mayapur, and they had some caterer bring in some non-vegetarian things to eat, so that the British government men could be peaceful. So he was in this way quite broad-minded. In Calcutta was started by the British. Prior to the British, Saptagram was the important place. So that was the main port. But the British, they wanted Calcutta as the capital, so they arranged that some wealthy investors from Saptagram would buy a lot of land, and in this way they established the city of Calcutta. In the center of Calcutta is a big field known as the Maidan. This Maidan, now there is the Victoria Memorial. There is a building dedicated to Queen Victoria. Looks a little bit like Prabhupada Samadhi. It's a dome, but our dome is a little bigger. But it's a big building. So also next to that is a place known as Fort Williams. So Fort Williams was interesting because Fort Williams was originally founded by scholars from Oxford and with some military support, but they particularly came on a mission to collect Vedic manuscripts. And even today, they have. So even today, so Fort Williams, right, had the agenda to collect many manuscripts. Now, my disciple Gopinath Acharya is the head librarian of the Hindu faculty in Oxford. And he tells me that Oxford has many, many underground cellars where they keep all kinds of manuscripts. And that there are cellars full of manuscripts from Fort Williams that have never been catalogued. They're just put into a room and they're just being kept and they're still waiting for someone to catalog. So in the future, some really interesting things could come up because it's all Gaudiya. It's our tradition. So just wait and see what they come up with. Some interesting books may come to the fore. Srila Bhakti Siddhanta organized what was called a theistic exhibition on the Maidan. It was a very big exhibition, and he had many dioramas. So dioramas like statues depicting in particular pastimes. Right? And in this way, people would come, and then around the theistic exhibition, he had a cultural exhibition of every state. So every state of India had some representation there, some clothes from their particular, and some crafts from their particular place. So just to attract everyone. and to make people identify. So he was not just like preachy. He was ready to take a step to bring people on board and engage with them in a way that they could relate. And that's what Srila Bhaktisiddhanta did. Srila Bhaktisiddhanta is the acharya who built a bridge from tradition to modernity. Okay? He gave the... We are sitting here, you know, on sofas, some of us. Some are still traditional on the carpet, but some of us are having sofas. And that is all possible now because Srila Bhaktisiddhanta emphasized this Yukta Vairagya teachings of Rupa Goswami, Nirbandha Krishna Sambandha Yukta Vairagya Uchite. You just take material things and engage them in the service of Krishna. And so he started that, you know, using cars, using, and here we are, you know, having the latest phone and, you know, and so many sexy things, goody goodies, and it's all bona fide if you use it in the service of Krishna. That's a little. Srila Bhaktisiddhanta himself had, of course, lived in the in a very traditional way, and had, in his own practices, just stayed in a hut in Mayapur, and he had taken the same vow as Haridas Thakur to chant a billion names at 300,000 names a day. That takes 10 years to complete. So he took this 10-year vow to chant 300,000 names a day, and he did that. And in the rainy season, he wouldn't even bother when there's a leaking roof to fix it because he's just chanting. And he just opened his umbrella and let the water come in and just kept on chanting. So we can understand, you know, that we're dealing here with especially empowered Nietzsche Siddha. And Srila Prabhupada said that my spiritual master is not an ordinary spiritual master. So it is Srila Bhaktisiddhanta who who gave us the connection with the tradition, who established that anybody could be initiated regardless of caste or creed, who established the tradition that we were part of, and finally, who brought it all into a modern shape so that modern people can practice Krishna consciousness in their own culture and lifestyle. And so it happens. Time is flying, of course. That's usually what time does. So I want to say a few things about Srila Bhakti, about Srila Korkasordas Babaji Maharaj. So we should all, before I go there, let's just close on Srila Bhaktisiddhanta. We should all make a personal relationship with Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur. Read about him. Read whatever, if there are some books available, some of his writings, let's have a look at it. Maybe we don't understand everything, but anyway, let's at least get an idea of his life. Our Bhakti Vikas Maharaj certainly did, made a huge effort, Bhaktisiddhanta Vaibhav, a book worth reading. Then, in Srila Prabhupada, as the disciple of Srila Bhaktisiddhanta, was a very faithful disciple. And was, whatever order his Guru Maharaj gave, he was 100% dedicated to it. Srila Prabhupada went to preach on the order of his spiritual master in the Western world, and of course was greatly successful. Once he had established this movement in the Western world, then Prabhupada brought back his devotees to India. He wanted to start a world Sankirtan party, and with that world Sankirtan party came to India, first to Surat, and it was a huge thing. Yeah, everyone was just, there are videos of that, and the people of Surat were all Vaishnavas, Gujaratis. And when they saw these Western Vaishnavas dancing and so ecstatic, they were just amazed. The mayor declared a public holiday. Good mayor. And they decorated all the streets with saris and colorful cloth, you know. It was an incredible event. And then Prabhupada did big programs. He did in Mumbai, then known as Bombay. He did a big pandal program, enormous. So all the dignitaries of Bombay were coming to Prabhupada's lectures to see these foreign sadhus and to hear the saint. They could all understand. So Prabhupada spread this work, and then he started to systematically develop projects in India with his Western disciples. It's like when I joined you in Vrindavan, there were very few Indian devotees, very few. It was all Westerners running everything. So we were all like, you know, some learned Hindi and, TK. Achcha, 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 achcha. Jarur. Ha ha ha. No. It's very important. In India, you have to know how to argue. If you want to know why cricket is so popular in India, it's just it's a boring sport most of the time. It's just not much action. It's not like baseball or something, you know, it's not much action. But the good thing about it is you can argue. They love it. I was watching, even the kids were doing it, just watching them yesterday, arguing. It's the tradition. So it became very popular in India. Anyway, nothing bad to say about India. I think India is a very wonderful place. It is head and shoulders above the rest of the world, right? In its piety, in its devotion. Of course, Kali Yuga, chal raha hai. What to do? Kali Yuga is going on. Anyhow, but still, we are happy. So Srila Prabhupada established his movement in India. It is said that Srila Prabhupada wanted every year that there would be a Gorpunim festival, 1 week in Mayapur and 1 week in Vrindavan. And that was going on for many, many years, and still going on in a way, but like now everybody comes anytime, but then particularly they would come at that time. They would sometimes charter whole planes, right? Jamastami, you were ever on one of those planes from America?
Yes.
Yeah?
Oh, no, the chartered planes, no.
The chartered planes, right? Where the whole plane was just devotees. Yeah. They even had Guru Puja and all these things. And chant Sari Ra Vijajal over the sound system on the plane. So that was very nice. Anyhow, so one particular, Srila Prabhupada had given sannyas to many men, but some had fallen down. So Prabhupada was getting a little hesitant about giving sannyas, and he said, no more sannyas. But then Tripurari asked for sannyas, and Rameshwar was pushing it, and Tripurari was, of course, a big book distributor. So Prabhupada said, okay, he can take. So he arranged. And then I was here in Vrindavan. And Bhima describes how they all went from Bombay by train to Vrindavan and for the festival. Or maybe from Mayapur, I think so. Not from Bam, must be Mayapur. Anyway, they were on the train, and there was one older Indian man sitting the entire way on the floor next to the bathroom, right? And they were just traveling, and nobody knew who he was. And then when at one point it was time for the initiation of Tripurari Sannyas initiation, then there were two seats and two dandas. And then suddenly there was this old man who had been sitting next to the bathroom, and nobody had any idea who he was. And he became Gaura Govinda Swami. Gaura Govinda Swami was from Orissa. And he had in Bhuvaneshwar, some land had been donated, and there was nothing on that land. It was dry. There was just a hut. There was hardly any water on it. It was hot. It was austere. There was every bacteria and germ you can imagine. So it was super intense and very, very austere. He stayed there on that land, and he held the land and just was a tremendous sadhu in his purva janma, as they say, in his life before sannyas. He had been a school teacher, so he was inclined towards learning. And he was learned, and he would study in the night, and his lectures were very erudite. Gaura Govinda Maharaj had notebooks also. He had a huge stack of notebooks full of study notes, right? And he used to bring these notebooks. When Gaura Govinda Maharaj was giving a lecture, I remember them very well, the Mangala Charan, you know, like usually we chant Om Gyan Timurandasya Ginandanas Lagya Saksulamita Minatas Mahesh Guru Be Namaha. Maybe, you know, 1 minute, 2 minutes, some three, you know, four, but like that's it. With Gaura Govinda Maharaj, that was 45 minutes. So many mantras. It goes through the whole Mangala Charan and so many mantras. And then, you know, supposed to like, okay, the class is supposed to be over. Then it would only start. So it was just quite amazing. And he spoke with so much authority, right? All based on scripture. And his whole thing was tattva, right? Establishing tattva, establishing siddhanta, establishing the truth. And so, you know, he got many followers because there's so much emphasis on tattva. There was in his following also maybe a little, some were very, very strong about their opinions, and it created a little clash sometimes with in ISKCON. But, and Gaura Govinda Maharaj felt misunderstood. He had said things that a guru has to be an uttama adhikari, has to be a pure devotee, you know. He meant to be, and that was like, okay, you know, don't say these things. but he had so much substance. At the time, in 1985, if I remember it, or was it 83? Maybe 83. The GBC made a few more gurus. Up to that point, they had only the 11, right? But then they made a few more. And one was Gopal Krishna Maharaj, another one was Bhakti Srup Damodar Maharaj, and the next one was Gaura Govinda Maharaj. So again, the whole movement was, who's he? Gaura Govinda Swami, we never heard of him. Now, of course, Gaura Govinda Maharaj has become much more famous. His disciples have done very well in taking his lectures, making them into books, and making that widely available to the world. Gaura Govinda Maharaj, indeed, is a tattva acharya. You know, we have
some tattva acharyas in our tradition who really established tattva. And Gaur Govinda Maharaj is such a tattva acharya who was deeply relishing the Chaitanya Charitamrita, a great devotee of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and Lord Nityananda. All right, so I remember that particular day. It was the celebration of Srila Bhakti Siddhanta. And later in the afternoon, Srila Gorgasurdas, Srila Gorgovinda Swami was in his room. He stayed in the Conch building in room 68, and which was on the second floor, Indian second floor, British second floor. Anyway, he was there, and he was speaking to two devotees who were asking him questions about the forms of Jagannath, Baladev, and Subhra. And he was telling that story, how these forms manifested due to separation. And that when they were in Kurukshetra, that they were remembering Vrindavan, and that then all the limbs start to enter into the body, just like Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. When he was in ecstasy, his limbs also entered into the body. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is known as Kurma Chaitanya, the tortoise Chaitanya. Yeah. So in the same way, Jagannath, Baladev, and Subhadra also. So Maharaj was speaking about this and explaining the ecstasy they all felt. And as he explained it, in the middle of speaking, his voice choked and he could not speak any further. And he basically left his body right there in the middle of that discussion. I was just standing on the ground, you know, in the courtyard in front of the temple, below his room, right? Just right below the room. So somebody called, something happened to Gaur Govinda Maharaj. So I flew up the stairs, you know, in those days I could fly. So I flew up the stairs and I was there within seconds, you know, and I saw Maharaj's mouth was hanging open. Then I knew, you know. Then I knew. It's like gone. Then we discussed, put a cloth, you know, put a cloth and tie up Prabhupada also. Yes. So, and, gradually more and more devotees came. We had kirtan and, Gaur Govinda Maharaj is taken on a palanquin for darshan, a final darshan of the deities. And because Bhuvaneshwar was his project, his disciples wanted Maharaj, his body, his samadhi, to be in Bhuvaneshwar. So they brought the body to Bhuvaneshwar and made the samadhi there. An extraordinary devotee, and we can greatly recommend to read all the teachings that came from Gaur Govinda Maharaj. So Gaur Govinda Swami Maharaj ki jai. Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur Avyabhav Maha Mahotsav ki jai. Hare Krishna. Okay, I'm going to take questions now, and I take one from online, which is Dayalu from Slovenia, Ljubljana. And
Hare Krishna.
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Well, Maharaj, I had this question also last week. Maybe we can connect it also to Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Maharaj. What would you say, how can one develop affections? Affection? The question was from last week was towards Prabhupada. How can one develop affections towards Prabhupada? And how can one develop also towards Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati? You mentioned we should read, but can you also say something more, please?
Yeah, affection is a result, you know. First of all, we need some purification, because in the introduction of the Nectar of Devotion, Srila Prabhupada explains about love and that the loving propensity is within everyone, but he's pointing out that that love is mostly misdirected, right, at the wrong object. So when the love becomes purified, it becomes directed towards Krishna and his devotees. So as our loving propensity becomes purified, we start to appreciate what an amazing personality Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur is. It's just incredible. He is so sharp, so totally brilliant. Right? I have on my website, kkswami.com, there are 64 statements of Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur, which are like crystal clear and very much like to the point. You know, Nitai, you have your phone?
No.
Okay, then leave it. You can find them. Then we'll read a few. So, after we are purified and our affection is directed towards Krishna and his devotees, then naturally we start to appreciate what an amazing sacrifice these acharyas have made for us. And naturally our loving propensity is, get your hand out of the way, then I'll take it. no problem. I just don't want any accidents. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's instructions in Siksaktakam, Param Vidayate Sri Krishna Sankirtanam, is the only motto of the Gaudiya Math. The Supreme Personality of Godhead, Sri Krishna, is the only enjoyer. Everyone and everything else is the object of his enjoyment. Anyone who does not serve Hari, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, is ignorant and a killer of himself. To learn to tolerate is one of the most important responsibilities of those living in the math. Can translate those living in the temple. Rupanuga devotees offer all glories to the original source instead of depending on their own strength. Those who perform assorted religious activities cannot serve the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Become united with one purpose and serve Hari. Where there's discussion about Hari, that is a place of pilgrimage. We are not pious, sinful, or learned, or ignorant. We are the carriers of the dust of the feet of the Supreme Lord, Sri Hari, and we are initiated by the mantra, Kirtaniya Sada Hari. My advice is, do not criticize others. Try to rectify yourself. Our supreme duty is to serve the residents of Raja, who are afflicted by Krishna's departure to Mathura. A pure devotee knows that everyone is the spiritual master. Therefore, a pure devotee can be Jagat Guru. Now, this was 12. You know, so there are 64 here, and as you can see, they're very, very clear, right? Very clear goals. If we live by these goals, then we're doing pretty good. Therefore, we can gradually appreciate how much mercy comes from Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur. I'll put it here. Oop. Yeah. Okay, Brihat Merdanga.
Hare Krishna, Guru Maharaj. So Maharaj, you were talking about the Dham, Maharaj. And I wanted to ask that when one resides in the Dham, how can we avoid taking it for granted and always just being in the correct mood to get maximum benefit.
We can't. We will take it for granted because we're conditioned souls. Only when we are liberated souls can we finally stop taking it for granted. So again and again, we will take it for granted. We tend to do that. But as we are getting more and more purified by the process of devotional service, we start to appreciate the mercy of the Dham more and more. In this way, we gradually get there, but still a long, long way to go. Okay.
Perfect.
Thank you. I'm going to take a question from the floor. Yeah, Rukmini.
Marj, I was wondering if Gaur Govinda Marj was ill, but it was just a sudden departure.
Well, it was sudden, but it was a heart issue. It was a heart issue. He was 68 years old at the time. And so it was the heart that conked out. Heart attack. Yeah. We can speculate, you know, I don't want to do that. But obviously he was old, so when you're old, your chance of getting a heart attack is a little bigger. And he was not underweight also. Yeah.
Hare Krishna. I was once told that when the guru leaves the world, there can be a bit of chaos in the aftermath. And I was just wondering, is this a generalization, and why would there be chaos?
It is a generalization, but there will be chaos because suddenly that person we could turn to is not there now, and we kind of... People get overwhelmed with grief. Different people have their own ideas of what the guru wanted and said. And so some of these differences will come out. And but at least we're fortunate, you know, that there are so many recordings these days, right? So he lives forever, right, in his vani. In his words, right? So these words are widely available these days. So, and yeah, you know, there's a book called Diary of the 70s by Satsarup Maharaj. And it's nice because it starts in 1971 or something like that. And then it goes 77, and then it goes post-77. And then it describes what happened and how they dealt with it, and after a while they realized, well, you know, okay, Prabhupada's not here now physically, but we are still devotees, and we still, there's still devotional service, we still chant Hare Krishna. So they kind of, after grieving for some time, they resumed taking shelter of their service, and there things came back to some level of normality. And then it took a lot of maturing, right? When the spiritual master leaves, one has to mature. Because at that point, the responsibility is on you to be Krishna conscious. He's not going to drag you along somehow or other, right? When he's present, he can do something. You know, he sees, oh, well, this one needs a push. Of course, he can still appear in a dream and so on, but... that's not a daily affair. So a lot of the responsibility goes back to us. So it takes us into the next level of maturity where we ourselves say, now I am going to be what he wanted us to be. No. I'm trying to leave some book or something, you know, that people can read. Where these kind of things are discussed. It's sitting with the publication department. Okay, now Yao is next to Lassie Toshani. He has had her hand up for weeks. I hope your arm is okay.
You hope my arm's okay?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's muscle. So my question is, Srila Prabhupada did a little what Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasvati Thakur did with what regards Shudras can becoming Brahmanas, or any caste can become Brahmana with qualification. Did Srila Prabhupada did kind of the same thing with the women? Like, did he kind of bring this kind of new...
No.
How can I say that?
It wasn't new.
Because women could go as brahmacharinis and...
Well, he did new things.
Brahmans on the altar.
Yeah, he did some new things. His sister was also initiated by Srila Bhaktisiddhanta. So Srila Bhaktisiddhanta was also ready to initiate ladies. So it wasn't just Prabhupada who started that. He followed his spiritual master. And then, of course, you know, when he went around the world, then, because there is so much free mixing outside of India, right? It's more difficult to separate people. So if you preach in the West, you're going to preach to both men and women. That's the nature it is. And yes, Srila Prabhupada could see in India the ladies could stay at home because their parents had at least some Vedic culture. Yeah? Mm-hmm. And then, you know, they could stay at home. But in the West, you know, there's absolutely nothing, right? So therefore, there had to be an ashram for the ladies and for the unmarried ones. And then Prabhupada married them all to devotees. And he arranged marriages, right? Just like Burijan's marriage is famous because Burijan was in Hong Kong and at one point complaining to Prabhupada that he was preaching all alone. And Prabhupada said, okay, I'll send you a wife. And about some 10 days later, she arrived and said, pleased to meet you, I'm your wife.
Wow.
And they're still together. It's still too,
And in that regard, if I may, please add some more question. Well, it's like just a continuation on the same question, basically. And you know, Prabhupada said many things about women, and like one of these things is like they're less intelligent than men, something like that. And then in Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, among women, and the intelligence of the women. So what would be that intelligence of the women?
Intelligence amongst the women. What is this? Sorry. Somebody planted some medicine on my table. intelligence obviously means to be Krishna conscious. Right? And when we are choosing to be Krishna conscious, the Vedic definition of intelligence is not the square block in the round hole and these kind of things, you know, where we do those kind of tests. The Vedic definition of intelligence is that we can act according to the proper absolute truth. So we have read the truth, and now one can act according to that. Not like that we say, oh, it's so difficult. I am trying. Which means I'm not doing it, but... the intelligent ladies are the one who are actually embracing the absolute truth. That's intelligence in ladies, and live by it. That is the definition, the Krishna conscious definition of intelligence. Thank you.
I guess we have like extra power, like because the men are kind of attracted by women. So as women, if we control ourselves and direct properly, then men will be more.
Butter fire and all that stuff. Butter fire dynamics may be there. You know, the female body is a reflection of Radharani's body. Male is a reflection of Krishna's body. The power of Radharani is greater in attracting Krishna than Krishna can attract Radharani. Therefore, women are more powerful in attracting men than men are in attracting women. Therefore, women, they just have to smile. Men, they have to talk for it. Anyway, Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Adi Ras.
Hare Krishna, dear Guru Maharaj, please accept my humble obeisances. Maharaji, I have heard in a Katha that once at a time, Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur was in Vrindavan with his disciple, and they were discussing, they saw a man near Radha Kund. I don't remember the complete conversation. So he said that we worship Krishna because of Radharani, for the pleasure of Radharani. Is it? Yes, Maharaji. He said to his disciple.
Sometimes Srila Bhaktisiddhanta would speak about such intimate matters, but very rarely. Right? He went also to Radha Kund and gave lectures on the Upanishads. Right? Day after day, he just gave lectures on the Upanishads, and everyone was waiting for, you know, Radharani ki jai, Maharani ki jai. And there was absolutely nothing. There was just Upanishads. Yes. So, but one day, Srila Bhaktisiddhanta did speak about rasa and said, this is not owned by the sahajas. This is actually our property. So although we are not qualified, we can just discuss it, just to understand the tattva. But we are not ready to absorb ourselves in the rasa. Yeah, rasa rani, radharani, all that. It's like, you know, if we make that our meditation, then we will soon encounter our lack of absorption. And we don't have this depth of love that they have, then we will not be able to maintain our meditation. Therefore, one should not rush ahead. So Srila Bhaktisiddhanta was, in that regards, encouraging his disciples to follow Lord Nityananda. He said, Nitai pada bine bai Radha Krishna paitanai. He said, without the mercy of Lord Nityananda, you cannot attain Radha and Krishna. He said, for those who are in Madhurya Ras, that means already realized their Siddhadeha, their identity, for them Radharani is the Guru. And for everyone else, Nityananda. So I guess that makes it clear where we belong. Jaya Nityananda Ram, Nityananda Ram, Nityananda Ram, Jaya Nityananda Ram. Okay, anybody here? Yadunat.
Hare Krishna Maharaj. Hare Krishna Maharaj, Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur Maharaj, he appears to be, he is totally a traditionalist as well as a great revolutionary. How did he manage to sort of traverse that spectrum? Or is that a necessary condition for a somebody in tradition?
Yeah, the nature of this Krishna consciousness movement is that on the one hand, the teachings of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu cannot be changed, it cannot be altered. So whatever comes through the parampara must be unchanged and must be faithfully presented. But at the same time, it may be presented according to Kaladesa Patra, a time, place, and circumstance. So, therefore, not that we are changing the principles, but sometimes the form of things is adjusted, some customs are adjusted. It's not just like Srila Bhaktisiddhanta fed the British, right, visitors, non-vegetarian item, but he himself had nothing to do with it. He just arranged for some outside catering to provide for them so that they would feel comfortable. So that was totally revolutionary. Yeah. So he was revolutionary in that way, but very strict about the tradition himself and very transcendental. So this is needed. This mood is needed. And Prabhupada also. Well, Prabhupada came to the West. Prabhupada said, we don't come to take anything from the West. We come to give. So Prabhupada came to give. So he didn't change anything because he was getting something from the West. No, he came to give. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I'm going to end because physical conditions are asking some attention. So, what can I do? I have to end here, and it happens to be 16:27. So that's 3 minutes before the end. Those who had their hands up, if you keep it up for 1 week, then then I'll take it again next week. What can I do? Just think of Krishna lifting Govardhan Hill. He held it up for 1 week. Yeah? So it's in our tradition to keep the arm up for 1 week. I can do it with the left hand, you know. Okay, I thank you very, very much. Hare Krishna. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur Prabhupada ki jai. Srila Gaur Govinda Swami Maharaja ki jai. Ananta Koti Vaishnava Vinda ki jai.